one power. About a century after Charles and Myrtle Fillmore founded the Unity Movement, their great-granddaughter, Reverend Connie Fillmore Bazzi, was asked to write an article for the Daily Word, our little magazine that we read on Sunday mornings, and many of you read it daily. She was asked to write an article and condense the major beliefs that we have in Unity. So she wrote the article, and the article became really popular. So she was asked to pull out and write concisely the bullet points, so to speak, of this article that she had written. And it was to be used for a month-long study. The booklet that was sent out to Unity Churches was named Keys to the Kingdom. So she pulled out what she saw, five major points within Unity's teaching, that based in metaphysics. And those became so popular that we then, the Unity Movement, we started printing a small booklet named The Five Unity Principles. Isn't it beautiful how Spirit works with things? She wrote the article in the beginning because she was asked to. At the time, she was an ordained minister, but also president of Unity School. And so, probably in her mind, she thought, well, you know, thank you for asking me to do this article, and maybe this would just be it. Not knowing how what Spirit had planned was far bigger than just this one article in the Daily Word magazine. So it became the Five Unity Principles, and it spread quickly over Unity Churches, and Unity Churches started teaching it. And for years now, probably ever since I've been in the movement, the five basic principles have been like a lighthouse to us. It's simple, easy statements that we can accept as capital T truth and use those statements to enhance our lives and enhance the lives of those around us. So today, I'm starting a five-part series on the five Unity Principles. And the first principle is what we say every Sunday morning: there is only one presence and one power in the universe and in me, God the Good, Omnipotent. Sometimes we, when we are accustomed to saying a certain quotation or group of words, they kind of lose their meaning over time. So it's especially important, I think, to really look at this. There is only one presence and one power. One presence and one power. There are scriptures. As far as I know, most, if not all, world religions teach this. There is only one actual power, and we are all connected to that power. Whether we are behaving that way or not, as Gary brought up, you know, people that cut us off in traffic and maybe we don't respond really well, or maybe we allow certain behaviors of other people to bother us or anger us and that sort of thing. And I'm using the word allow on purpose, because we and we alone have control over how we react, no matter what the situation. Even though we would probably agree, trying to explain God and make a definition that would be a be-all, end-all definition of God is not even possible. We say we know that God is infinite. God is knowledge. God doesn't just have knowledge. God is the knowledge. God is the potency. God is the all in all. And yet our minds are not set up to be able to grasp that. Our minds are set up for a beginning and an end. That we can easily get. It began on this day and it ends on this day. We can understand that. But something that was never created and never will pass away is not really within our grasp of most people. However, as human beings, we have this need to explain our world and make sense of our world. So we make a running stab at trying to explain who God is, what God is, what is our understanding, at least currently today. So having said all of that, there are many names for God, many names. Here's just kind of a short list. God, Great Spirit, Creator, Higher Power, Divine Presence, the I Am, Source Energy, First Cause, and for you Star Wars fans, the Force. May the Force be with you. We still give it our best running guess about what God is. As far as being able to explain it in words, we cannot. Because any word that we have has a definition. And it puts boundaries around God. But here is how we define God, in my estimation. Close your eyes. And let your mind go to your heart. The heart is where we generally think of love, compassion, kindness, goodness, serving, those kinds of things. Allow yourself just to feel that presence that is always within. Never a split second that it has gone from us. It's always, always there. That is God. You can open your eyes when it feels comfortable. Whereas this is not necessarily words, but we can drop into and know that feeling anytime, anytime, in the midst of chaos, in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of anger, that God self is always there, gentle, compassionate, and waiting. Waiting for us to show up in consciousness. There are various scriptures in putting this talk together, various scriptures that come up. There's a Christian scripture in the New Testament. There is one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all, Ephesians 4, 5 through 7. So that our Bible tells us, in that scripture especially, that there is only one God, there is only one power, only one presence. And many times, we even will question that in our own minds, in our own hearts. But when we question it even that is sacred. When we question it, some of your deepest questions have probably come up with some of your biggest answers. And sometimes there is no answer forthcoming. Maybe it is not even humanly possible to know an answer. Rainer Maria Rilke wrote this from Letters to a Young Poet. I want to beg you, dear friend, as well as I can, to have patience with everything that remains unsolved in your heart. Try to love the questions themselves. If we go within and we try to drum up an explanation about and a definition about God, and we just cannot come up with anything that even is remotely close, be happy to stay with the questions. Be okay, at least, to stay with the questions. We are one with each other. There are many teachings around the world that teach this very thing. God hath made one blood of all nations, that is in Acts. In Hinduism, all the sons and daughters of God, good people all brothers and sisters, since created by one God. In Judaism, we have we not all one Father? Hath not one God created us? And this Sioux Native American, God is our Father, Earth is our Mother. With all things and in all things, we are related. Because we are one with God, we also are one with each other. We are one with everything. And that's another thing that our minds usually can't wrap around, that we are one with everything, that we are connected to everything. When we really get the crux of that teaching, would we ever do anything to harm anyone else on purpose? To harm anything else when we know that all we're doing is harming our own selves? Of course not. Of course not. So when we talk about one power, the obvious thing always comes up. If there's only one power and God is controlling or is in control ultimately with everything, then why does God allow evil? That is a question that has been approached for centuries, probably as far back as history has been written. We know that people have been asking that. Why does God allow the atrocities that go on in the world? The only answer that I can come up with that satisfies me is free will. Free will. We are given free will to take whatever we have and do whatever we will with what we have, the intelligence, the material possessions, whatever it is that we have free will to do, speak, and be whatever it is that we're wanting at that time. We each have that. If God were, yes, I believe that God could cause peace on earth just in the flash of an eye. However, that would take away free will. God gave that to us from the very beginning. So in order for these things to happen in the world, guess what? It's up to us. As the Native American Hopi writing, at the end of it, the end of this long, beautiful poem, it says, we are the ones we've been waiting for. We cannot wait for other people to do the things that we see need to be done. Pointing fingers never brought peace on earth. Blaming other people. It's up to us. We are God's representatives in this world. The first time I heard that was from my Bible teacher in seminary. She said to us, and probably pointing a finger, "You are God's representatives." A bit of background on her, E.J. Niles. She was formerly an officer in the Air Force. She was my Bible teacher. You are God's representatives. It is up to us. We may not be Gandhi or Martin Luther King or Mother Teresa, but we can affect, and we do affect, this much of our world every single day, every single minute of every single day. We are God's representatives. We are God's expressions in this world. And the other side of that is, we are going to fall short of even our own expectations. There will be times when, I'll just make it personal, when I'm tired or hungry, or tired and hungry, everything is just, I feel like I'm not really expressing who I really am. I do my best not to allow those things to happen, you know, to be tired and hungry, or one or each. But sometimes it happens anyway. There are going to be times that we are going to express something other than our God self in this world. When that happens, if it's something that we in our heart and in our mind know that we need to go back and clean it up, we need to apologize to the person, or we need to rectify a situation, then do it. As soon as we realize what we have done, forgive ourselves. We are human beings. We are learning as we go. We are really in this world like little kids of about a year old. Little kids pull up on the furniture, learning to walk. And maybe they take a step and let go and fall. Well, that doesn't really stop them. The next time they pull up, maybe they'll make two steps. This is how we are in the world. We are finding our legs in this world. When we are out in the world addressing or being with anyone, we are God's representatives. We are God's expression in this world. When I first heard Reverend E.J. say that, "You're God's representative," it felt like, oh my gosh, what a weight. But then I thought, what a great opportunity. What a great opportunity. This makes it, it shifts something in my mind to realize that out in the world, I am how God expresses. One expression, I am. And each of you are the same. The Aramaic word for evil is bisha, the Aramaic word used in the Bible. And what this word actually means is immature or unripe. Evil means immature or unripe. It just means that when we do things that are not in keeping with who we know that we are, the God's representative in the world, that we're just acting from a place of immaturity. We don't yet know how to act in a situation like that. And so we go along and we mature over time. One presence and one power in the universe and in me and you. God the good, omnipotent. And that goes for every single human being on this earth, no exceptions. We each are God's expression in this world. We may not be acting on it. We may see others who are not acting like God in this world. But we are all God expressing out in the world. Charles Fillmore. There is but one presence and one power, God, omnipotent. But man has the privilege and freedom of using this power as he will. When he misuses it, and it brings about inharmonious situations. These are called evil. Evil appears in the world because man is not yet in spiritual understanding. He can do away with evil by learning rightly to use the one power. This is simply where we are, learning to use the one power that is within us. So I want to leave you with a quotation. Ellen Devenport, Reverend Ellen Devenport, was the minister in Wimberley for 10 years, I think. Recently went to work at Unity Village. She wrote a book named The Five Unity Principles. This is what she wrote. Principle one maintains we are one with God, not separate. Not being watched, but immersed in the divine. As the Apostle Paul wrote to the Athenians, we live and move and have our being in God and in oneness. God lives and moves and has expression in us. One power, one presence. We each have it. I invite you to express it. Thank you.